This is the earring. L 4 coefficient. N is the additive white Gaussian noise. And X is the, this is the transmitted. And X is the transmitted symbol, and we derived an expression for the bit error rate of this system. We said that the bit error rate of this system, the bit error rate, that is given as, that is approximately equal to half 1 over 1 plus half SNR, approximately equal to 1 over SNR at high SNR, that is at high SNR. So we have seen that this bit error rate, that this bit error rate of the wireless communication system decreases at 1 over SNR. Therefore, we also computed the approximate SNR required to achieve a probability of error 10 power minus 6. For 10 power minus 6 bit error rate, we have 10 power minus 6 equals 1 over SNR, implies required SNR for bit error rate of 10 power minus 6 is equal to 10 power 6 equals 60 dB, right? So this is 60 dB SNR that is required for a wireless communication system compared to a wired communication system, compared to a conventional AWG and channel based communication system. So basically, so what we have is, yeah, I am getting a question. I'll just come to that. I'll answer that later. I'm doing a recap of what we did last time. And therefore, what we we have an SNR that is 60 dB, and we said the SNR is much higher compared to the SNR that is required a conventional AWGN system, right? And conventional that is AWGN system without phoenix, that is a conventional landline communication system without multipath propagation. And what we also saw that this arises basically because of the deep fading nature of the wireless channel. We computed what is the probability of deep fade. We said, if you remember, we said what the probability of deep fade is basically when the received signal power is received signal power is less than or equal to noise power, which means basically, if you can see, received signal power is basically magnitude h square times p, and if this is less than or equal to noise power, that is basically sigma square, which means magnitude h square, that is g, less than or equal to sigma square over p equals 1 over SNR. Therefore, probability of deep fade is basically equal to the probability that g is less than or equal to 1 over SNR, and this probability is nothing but 0 to 1 over SNR e to the power of minus dg, and this we said is approximately equal to 1 over SNR. Therefore, basically the probability of deep fade in this wireless communication system, that is the probability that the received signal power is less than or equal to the noise threshold sigma square, is basically approximately 1 over SNR. And therefore, what we are seeing is the bit error rate, you can see this is 1 over SNR is what is basically the bitter rate. So the bitter rate is basically, we are seeing that the bitter rate, that is the probability of bitter rate, is probability of bitter is equal to the probability of the bitter rate, the probability of bitter is, the bitter rate is basically equal to the probability of the fail in this wireless communication system. That is essentially what we are seeing in this wireless communication. So basically what we are seeing is that in a wireless, to summarize, we are seeing in a wireless communication system, to achieve bitter rates of 10 power minus 6, 10 power minus minus 5 of that order, we need an extraordinarily high SNR, that is extraordinarily high transmit power, that is around 60 dB. Corresponding to the same thing for a wired communication system, that is a channel without aid of multipath propagation, you need only about 14 to 15 dB of SNR. So the basic problem in wireless communication system is the poor bitter rate or the poor performance of the wireless communication system due to the multipath fading, which results in SNR, which results in a poor SNR at the receiver, or which results in basically deep fade events at the SNR when the received signal power is very low due to the destructive interference that is basically arising from this multipath propagation, right? And we said that we are going to look at technologies in wireless communication, that is different wireless communication technologies, which will help us improve the quality of wireless communication system. That is, for instance, which will help us decrease the bitter rate of a wireless communication system. And these, one of these technologies we said is using multiple antennas. So we said one of the technologies to improve the bitter rate in a wireless communication system One of the technologies to improve the it is one of the technologies to improve the bitter rate. By improving the bitter rate, I mean by basically decreasing the bitter rate, right? Improving the bitter rate or decreasing the bitter rate of wireless communication system is to employ multiple antennas. That is, we employ multiple antennas. For instance, what do I mean by multiple antennas? We had looked at a basic example last time. I think everyone should remember the example that we did last time. What we did was we had a transmitter and a receiver. So I had a receiver I had a transmitter and previously we had only a single antenna at the transmitter and single antenna at the receiver, and this we had said is basically corresponding to the feeding channel coefficient H. Now what I'm saying is we are going to add one more antenna at the receiver, so now we are going to have two links corresponding to feeding channel coefficients H1 and H2. So if I'm transmitting a symbol X from the transmitter, I receive symbols Y1 and Y2 at the receiver. But basically Y1 corresponds to, this is basically the first antenna. And this is basically the this is the second antenna. Therefore, I have Y1 equals H1X plus, so at each antenna I have the received symbol, received signal Y1, Y2. Therefore, my system model, basically if I can write it down, that can be expressed as y1 equals h1 x1 plus n1, that is y1 received signal at receive antenna 1 is y1, which is not x1, sorry, this is, it should be x, because so y1 equals h1 x plus n1, y2 equals h2 x plus n2. So this is y1 is at antenna 1 and y2 is at antenna 2. Therefore now I can basically combine this as a vector. I can combine this as a vector, right? I can write this down as a vector, where I am going to write y1, y2 is the vector y bar, n is the, I am getting a question regarding n, n is the noise, that is n1 is the noise at antenna 1, n2 is the noise at antenna 2, right? So I am getting, so y bar equals h bar x plus n bar, right? N1 is the noise at antenna 1, n2 is the noise at n2 is the noise at, this is the noise at antenna 2. Therefore, I have y bar equals hx plus n bar, that is what I have. I have y bar equals h bar x plus n bar, where y bar, let me remind you again, you can see from above, y bar is basically the vector y1, y2, h bar is the vector h1, h2, n bar is the vector n1, n2. Right. So now what I can do is basically I have to process the received input outputs y1, y2. So now I have to process the received outputs y1, y2 to basically detect x. And what I am going to do at y1, y2 is I am going at the receiver is I am going to linearly combine y1, y2. I am going to linearly combine y1 and y2, right? So I am going to linearly combine y1, y2 at the receiver. And the way I am going to combine y1, y2 at the receiver is the following thing. Let w1 and w2 be the weights. These are the weights I am using for the different receive antennas. Then I am going to perform a linear combination at the receiver. I am going to perform W1 conjugate Y1 plus W2 conjugate Y2, which I can write as basically W1 conjugate, W1 conjugate which I can write as W1 conjugate W2 conjugate and W2. Now you can see this is basically equal to W bar Hermitian Y bar, right? Where vector y bar equals y1, y2, w1 comes in. So w bar equals w1, w2 implies w bar Hermitian equals w1 conjugate Therefore, you can see this vector, W1 conjugate, W2 conjugate is nothing but W bar Hermitian. This is W bar Hermitian. This is the vector W bar Hermitian. Okay. So, I have W bar Hermitian times Y bar. This is the weighted combination I am performing at the receiver. Now, let us substitute for Y1, Y2. Remember, we have this expression for Y1, Y2. We are coming to that question. I am getting a question, how are W1, W2 chosen? That is exactly what I am going to, that is what I am going to come to, how to choose the weights W1 and W2. So, we are going to perform W1 conjugate Y1 plus W2 conjugate Y2. Now, if I look at that, let us substitute for Y1, Y2. Y1 equals H1X plus N1, Y2 equals H2X plus N2. Therefore, I have W1, let me call this R. R equals W1 conjugate Y1 plus W2 conjugate Y2 equals W1 conjugate. Now for Y1, I have to substitute H1X plus N1 plus for Y2, I have to substitute H2X plus N2. And therefore, now I can collect the signal component and the noise component. For instance, the signal component is W1 conjugate H1 plus W2 conjugate H2 into X plus the noise component is W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2. So this is W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2. Okay, so this I am saying this is the signal component. Everyone can see that this is the and this is the noise component. This is the noise component. Now what I am going to do is I am going to compute the SNR at the receiver. Now I am going to compute the SNR at the receiver. So this is the signal component. This is the noise component. Now you can see two things. First, let us look at the signal component. Let us now look at the signal component. So what I am saying is I am performing W1 conjugate Y1 plus W2 conjugate Y2 at the receiver. That is, I am linearly combining the two received outputs Y1 and Y2 using the weights W1 and W2. So performing this linear combination, when I perform this linear combination, I have the signal component. The signal component is W1 conjugate H1 plus W2 conjugate H2 into X, and the noise component is W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2. Now observe that the signal component can also be written as, the signal component can also be written as, this is basically, this can also be written as W1 conjugate W2 conjugate H1. This can also be written as W1 conjugate W2 conjugate into H1 H2, which is nothing but basically W bar Hermitian into H bar, right? So this signal or signal power The signal power equals W bar permission H bar magnitude of this square times expected value of magnitude x square, which is basically, now we know expected value of magnitude x square, this is the transmitted power, therefore the signal power is W bar Hermitian H bar magnitude square times E. Okay, so what we are saying, output of the combiner, right, the signal power at the output of the combiner, in fact what I have to characterize, this is the signal power at the output of the signal power at the output of the combiner is W bar Hermitian H bar magnitude W bar Hermitian H bar square times P, where P is the, what is P? P is the transmitted power. P is the, this P is the P is the transmitted power, right? So the output of the output is the output of the combiner, the received power is magnitude W bar Hermitian H bar magnitude square times. Now let us look at what is the noise power. We have seen that the noise component is W1 conjugate N1 plus W1 conjugate N2. What is the noise power? The noise power can be calculated as follows. Let us assume that at the two antennas, each noise component is of power sigma square, that is expected magnitude N1 square equals expected magnitude N2 square equals sigma equals sigma square. Fine. And we will also assume that the noise components at the different antennas are uncorrelated. That is what is saying that the noise components at expected N1 N2 conjugate equals expected N1 conjugate N2 equals 0. That is what we are saying is that each noise component N1 and N2 is such that expected each noise component is of power sigma square, that is each noise component, what is this saying, each noise component is of power sigma square. And what is this saying? This is basically saying that the noise at the two antennas is uncorrelated. This says that the noise at the two antennas is uncorrelated. That is expected N1 N2 conjugate equals expected N1 conjugate N2 equals 0. Therefore, if I look at the net noise power, what is the net noise power? Remember, the noise at the receiver is W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2. Therefore, noise power is expected value of W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2. See, then remember that's what we said. This is the W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2. This is the noise component. Therefore, noise power is W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2 into conjugate of this quantity, W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2, the conjugate of this quantity, right? Magnitude square of this quantity is the power, which is basically equal to expected value of W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2 times W1 N1 conjugate, that is when I take the conjugate of this quantity, W2 N2 conjugate equals, now let us multiply this term by term, W1 conjugate N1 into W1 N1 conjugate, that is magnitude W1 square magnitude N1 square plus W2 conjugate N2 W2 N2 conjugate, this is magnitude W2 square magnitude N2 square plus W1 conjugate W2 N1 N2 conjugate, W1 conjugate W2 N1 N2 conjugate plus W2 conjugate N2 into W1 N1. Now look at this, right? So what we have expanded this is the effective noise at the receiver, that is if you look at the noise at the receiver, that is W1 conjugate N1 plus W2 conjugate N2, the power of this, therefore expected value of this quantity times its conjugate. And this we have expanded as magnitude W1 square, magnitude N1 square, magnitude W2 square, magnitude N2 square, W1 conjugate W2, N1, N2 conjugate, W2 conjugate N2, W1, N1 conjugate. Now let us look at this term by term. Now if we look at this term by term, look at this. I have magnitude W square into magnitude N1 square. What is the expected value of this quantity? If you can see from above, expected value of N1 square is sigma square. Therefore, the expected value of this quantity is magnitude W1 square sigma square. Fine. Is that clear to everybody? Because expected value of N1 square is sigma square, that is noise is of power sigma square. Expected value of magnitude W1 square times magnitude N1 square is sigma square times magnitude W1 square. What about the expected value of magnitude W2 square, magnitude N2 square? Can someone tell me what is the expected value of magnitude W2 square times magnitude N2 square? Can someone reply on chat? What is the expected value of magnitude W1 square, magnitude W2 square times magnitude N2 square? Can someone respond? What is the expected value of magnitude W2 square times magnitude N2 square? I'm getting some answer from GIT, but it's not correct. Magnitude, expected value of magnitude W2 square times magnitude N2 square. Not sigma squared. Please listen to the question carefully. It is expected value of magnitude W2 square times sigma square. That is the correct answer. It is W2 square, magnitude W2 square. So this is magnitude, expected value of magnitude N2 square is sigma square. So this is magnitude W2 square times sigma square. What about expected value of W1 conjugate W2 into N1 N2 conjugate? Can someone tell me what is the expected value of W1 conjugate W2 into N1 N2 conjugate? That is zero. Very good, very good. Several people are saying zero. GIT, PhD, all of them are saying zero. That is correct, because We have seen, as you have seen, GECTN, thank you, I got the answer. It is expected value of N1, N2, this is 0, right? Expected value of N1, N2 is 0. Similarly, about this term, W2 conjugate W1 into N2 N1 conjugate, you can see N2 N1 conjugate is also, expected value is also 0. Therefore, this term is also 0, this term is also 0 because the noise components are uncorrelated. Net what we have is expected value of noise power. The expected value of noise power is basically what is remaining. Remaining is W1, magnitude W1 square sigma 1 square plus magnitude W2 square sigma square. So basically expected value of noise power at the receiver. Magnitude W1 square sigma square plus magnitude W2 square sigma square equals sigma square into magnitude W square plus magnitude W square. Alright, so the noise power is basically magnitude sigma square into magnitude W1 square plus magnitude W2 square. But magnitude W1 square plus magnitude W square is nothing but the norm of the vector, because remember W bar equals W1, W2. Therefore, magnitude W1 square plus magnitude W2 square is nothing but the norm of the vector W bar. Therefore, this is sigma bar into norm bar square. This is the noise power. So, we have two components here. One is the signal power. Signal power is W Hermitian H magnitude square times D. Noise power is sigma square norm W square. This is therefore SNR, signal to noise power ratio, is signal power by noise power. Was magnitude W bar into D divided by norm W bar square into square. Therefore, the signal to noise power ratio at the receiver, signal to noise power ratio at the receiver is magnitude W bar Hermitian H bar square times P divided by norm W square times sigma. This is to signal to noise power ratio at the receiver. The signal to noise power ratio at the receiver. Any questions so far? Can anyone, is it clear to everyone how we have derived the signal to noise power ratio at the receiver? We have considered a two antenna system. We have assumed combining at the receiver, combining using the weights W1 and W2 for Y1 and Y2. That is, we have performed W1 conjugate Y1 plus W2 conjugate Y2. We have derived the expression, that is the signal to noise power ratio. Signal power is magnitude W bar Hermitian H bar square times P. Noise power is sigma square times norm of W bar square. Further, although we have derived it only for a two antennas, that is only because I wanted to consider a simple example. This is valid for a case of any general n antennas. That is, if H bar is the vector of n channel coefficients, that is h1, h2 up to hn, and w bar is the vector, combining vector of weights w1, w2 up to wn. The received this SNR after the combiner is magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square p divided by magnitude norm w bar square times sigma square. Okay, so this is basically the SNR at the receiver. Now what I'm going to do is basically look at this. Everyone must have studied the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. The Cauchy-Schwarz inequality at the for two vectors. Remember, we said the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality is basically if you have two vectors v and u, that is v and u, then we have v transpose u, that magnitude of v transpose u. Remember, Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, magnitude of v transpose u square is less than or equal to norm v bar square into norm u bar square, because v transpose u is magnitude v times magnitude u into norm u into cosine of theta, right? So this is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Remember, for the any two n dimensional vectors, v transpose u magnitude square is less than norm v square into norm u square. This is the right, this Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, right? So if I have two vectors v and u, then magnitude v transpose u square is less than or equal to norm v square, magnitude v square, or norm v square into norm u square. So now if I employ the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality here, I will have, because w and h are complex vectors, I will have magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square is less than or equal to, so I can write, employing Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, I have magnitude w bar Hermitian h square less than or equal to norm w bar square into norm h bar square. This is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So this is the key inequality that we are going to. This is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. That is magnitude w bar square. Magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square is less than or equal to norm w bar square into norm h bar square. Therefore, I have SNR, remember, equals e over sigma square into magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square divided by norm w bar square. Now see, magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square is less than or equal to this quantity, norm w bar square h square. Therefore, I will substitute, use this inequality to write that this is less than or equal to p by sigma square into norm w bar square norm h bar square divided by norm w bar square, where instead of, basically how am I getting this inequality? Because norm w bar, magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square is less than or equal to norm w bar square times norm h bar square. I'm using this property. Now you can see in the numerator and denominator, magnitude w bar square cancels. Therefore, I am getting this is equal to, SNR is less than or equal to norm h bar square divided by. Right. So the SNR is less than, will always be less than or equal to norm h bar square p over sigma square. when will it equal be equal to norm h bar square p over sigma square when magnitude of w bar Hermitian h square is equal to norm w bar square into norm h bar square. It is equal to this thing only if magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square is equal to norm w bar square into norm h bar square. Now can someone tell me, if I have two vectors w and h, when will magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square equal to norm w bar square, norm h bar square? Now my question to all students in the class is, when is magnitude w bar Hermitian square equal to norm w bar square norm h bar square? When is this, when does this occur? Can some of the students in the class respond via chat, when is magnitude w bar Hermitian h bar square equal to norm w bar square into norm h bar square? Can someone tell me when does this occur? When does this? In other words, what I am asking is, the question that I am asking is basically, if I have two vectors v and u, when is magnitude v transpose u square equals norm v bar square into norm bar square, when is this equal? Now I'm getting our answer as orthogonal. Orthogonal is not the correct answer, because if they are orthogonal, then v transpose u is 0, right? So the answer is not orthogonal. When is magnitude v transpose u square equals norm, when is magnitude v transpose u square equal to norm v square into norm u square for two vectors v and u, when they are parallel? I am getting an answer from GIT college, that is exactly correct. When v and u are parallel to each other, that is, they are aligned with each other, when v bar and u bar are overlapping, when v bar and u bar are overlapping, that is basically saying that w bar, this occurs when w bar is overlapping with h bar, or w bar is proportional to h bar. So what we will do is, w bar equals h bar divided by norm h bar. So w bar equals h bar divided by norm h bar. So when we have w bar equals h bar divided by norm h bar, when we have w bar equals h bar divided by norm h bar, that is when w bar is basically aligned with respect to h bar, that is when we choose the combining weights w bar such that w bar equals h bar divided by norm h bar, we will have basically this will be an equality, therefore we will have the SNR is equal to norm h square p divided by sigma square. So what this is saying is very interesting. What this is saying is, choose the combining weights w bar such that w bar is proportional to h bar. That is basically, this is similar to the concept of a matched filter that you have studied in communications. Remember, in a communication system, what is the matched filter? Match filter is nothing but the filter at the receiver, which is basically the conjugate flipped version of the transmit pulse shape, right? So you are basically matching the filter at the receiver to the transmitter. Similarly, in this scenario, you are matching the combining weights. The combining weights are being matched to the channel response. So this is actually a matched filter. This is the same thing as a matched filter in communication, except this is a matched filter across the antenna. So you can also think of this as a spatially matched filter. This is the spatial, S-P-A-T-I-A-L. This is the spatial. This is a spatially matched filter. So when I have a spatially matched filter, what I will have is I will have SNR is norm x square p divided by sigma square. So for a spatially matched filter, I will have SNR equal to norm h square p divided by sigma square. So for a spatially matched filter, I have SNR equals norm h bar square e over sigma square, which is equal to, remember, norm h bar square is also equal to magnitude h1 square plus magnitude h2 square times e over E over sigma square. Now denoting magnitude h1 square by g1, magnitude h2 square by g2. Remember, we always denote magnitude h square by g. That is the power. So this will be magnitude h1 square is g1. This is equal to g1 plus 2 into e over sigma square, where g1 is equal to magnitude h1 square g2 equals to h2 square. This is the SNR. In fact, this spatially matched filter is also known as the, this is also known as the maximal ratio combiner. When you choose your W weights, W such that W is basically not able to go to the previous page somehow. Thing is frozen, whiteboard is frozen. So the spatially matched filter is basically, this is also known as the, let me just see if I can go. That is, when I choose W bar equals H bar divided by norm H bar, this is also known as the maximal ratio combiner. Is also known as the maximal ratio combiner in brackets MR. Maximal ratio combining is basically MRC, right? Maximal ratio combiner. So if we employ the maximal ratio combiner, that maximizes the SNR at the output of the of this system with two receive antennas, and the SNR at the output is norm h square p divided by sigma square, which is magnitude h1 square plus magnitude h2 square into p divided by sigma square, which is equal to g1 plus g2 into p divided by sigma square. Now can someone tell me what is the bit error rate of this system? As a function of the instantaneous SNR, g1 plus g2 into p divided by sigma square, what is the instantaneous SNR of this So what is the instantaneous bit error rate? My question to all the students now is, what is the instantaneous What is the instantaneous bit error rate of this system? Can someone answer this question? What is the instantaneous? Can you look at what we have done previously? Can someone answer this question? What is the instantaneous? I am not asking about the average bit error rate. What is the instantaneous bit error rate? That is, at this moment of time, given that this is the received SNR, what is the instantaneous bit error rate? That is G1 plus G2 times P over sigma square. What is the instantaneous bit error rate of this wireless system? By instantaneous bit error rate, I am saying this is the bit error rate at the current time instant as a function of the channel gains G1 and G2. What is the instantaneous bit error rate of this wireless communication system? Can someone tell me what is the instantaneous bit error rate of this wireless communication system? No, it is not inverse of SNR because this is not is the output. What is the, it's not inverse of SNR because that is for a single antenna system. That is average bit error rate for a single antenna system. What is the bit error rate of this system? Can someone tell me the answer? What is the instantaneous bit error rate? Can you go back to look at how we started for the bit error rate for the antenna feeding wireless channel? Can someone look at what is the bit error rate for the single antenna feeding wireless channel? How we started it, not the average bit error rate. What is the instantaneous bit error rate? That is, what is the bit error rate as a function of the channel gain? Can someone look at that and think about it? Basically, from what we did for the AWGN channel, it is Q times square root Q of square root of SNR. Can someone tell me what is the instantaneous bit error rate for this channel? Remember for AWGN what we had for AWGN, the ideal white Gaussian noise channel, that is the bit error rate is Q of square root of SNR. Therefore, what is the bit error rate of this channel if the received SNR is G1 plus G2 times P over sigma square? Can someone tell me what is the bit error rate of this channel? What is the instantaneous bit rate of this? What is the instantaneous bit error rate of? What is the instantaneous bit error rate of this channel? Well, I'm not getting the correct answer. Actually, people are confusing this with the single receive antenna scenario. So let me give the answer. The instantaneous bit error rate, remember we said that is q of square root of SNR, so the instantaneous bit error rate is q of square root of g1 plus g2 times q over sigma square. That is the instantaneous bit error rate of this wireless communication system. So the instantaneous bit error rate is q of square root of SNR. So we have said SNR, received SNR equals g1 plus g2 into p over sigma square, and therefore we derived the instantaneous bit error rate. The SNR is given, then the instantaneous bit error rate is q over square root of SNR. So the instantaneous SNR and the output of the channel is basically q of square root of this is the instantaneous, this is q of square root of g1 plus g2 into p over sigma square. Now what we have to do, now we have to average this over the distributions. We have to average this over distribution of g1 and g2. Compute average error. Right. So basically, this is the instantaneous bit error rate. What I have to do now is basically now we have to average this over the distribution of g1 and g2 to compute the average bit error rate, and this we will do then in the next lecture. So what we have to do is we have to basically compute the average bit error rate for this multiple antenna communication system, and we are going to do this in the next lecture. Alright, thank you very much. Thank you. Since we are out of time, if you have any questions regarding this thing, I will take it in the next lecture, in the beginning of the next lecture. Alright, thank you everyone, thank you very much.